The last part of our discussion is audit of capital acquisition and repayment cycle. So, sa audit naman ng capital acquisition and repayment cycle, our concern here is about the way that the client raised their resources from creditors and from shareholders in the form of debt and equity. And how did they repay, no, yung mga principal, interest, and dividend to those resource provider. So, yung acquisition of capital resources through long-term interest-bearing debt from creditors and equity from shareholders and repayment of capital, yung mga classes of transactions involved in the capital acquisition and repayment cycle. Now, ano yung mga unique characteristics of this cycle naman? So, in this cycle, it consists of relatively few transactions. However, although few siya, individually they are considered material or significant. Halimbawa, issuance of bonds. So, do you think yung issuance ng bonds would involve a small amount? No. It would probably involve significant amount, including raising of capital from issuance of shares. No? Next, therefore, because of that, any exclusion or misstatement of just even one transaction could already be considered material. And finally, there is legal relationship between the entity and holders of stocks, bonds, or similar securities. Kaya mataas yung what? Mataas yung risk of material misstatement, mataas yung risk of non-compliance rather with laws and regulation. Okay? Kasi yung mga securities na yan, highly regulated siya na mga government regulators natin like SEC, for example. Okay? Yan ba? Si company, hindi siya pwede basta-basta mag-issue ng shares of stocks. Normally, may authorized number of shares. And there should be proper documentation and payment of taxes every time the entity issues shares or issue debt securities. And may mga restriction pa yan with respect sa legality na pag-issue ng shares. Like for example, if you wanted to issue shares to the public or debt instrument to the public, there are additional registration requirements on the part of SEC. So the different accounts in the cycle include the following. So we have the borrowings, like for example, notes payable, bonds payable, interest expense, accrued interest, treasury shares, so dividends declared, cash in bank, share capital, including ordinary share capital and preference share capital, and other equity line items such as share premium, retained earnings, and dividends payable. So for the design amount of our audit procedure, so we designed the subdetails of balances for long-term debt and equity after following the steps here. No? So first, we identify significant risk and assess the risk of material misstatement. We set our performance materiality and assess control risk. We design and perform our test of controls and substantive test of transaction. Design and perform substantive analytical procedures and design our test of details of balances. So similar lang din naman with other transaction cycles that we have discussed so far. So however, we'll discuss yung procedure as applied to several selected items sa audit ng long-term debt and equity. Yung mga major items na i-discuss natin. Starting with audit of payable. So with respect class audit of notes payable, we typically audit notes payable together with the related interest expense. So ang nature ng notes payable, it's a legal obligation to a creditor. It can be secured or unsecured, and it normally bears interest. And another characteristic ng notes payable is that if it is secured, then there would be a collateral or security, which is often a security, AR, accounts receivable, or an item of inventory or PPE, or property, plant, and equipment. So kaya meron din siyang consequence sa presentation and disclosure requirement. Okay? And usually yung main document that we use in auditing the note payable and interest expense is yung schedule of notes payable, which often includes information about the principal amount, the maturity amount, and yung schedule ng payment for both principal and interest. So kaya nga sabi natin earlier, when we audit notes payable, we also audit interest expense. Some considerations in audit that we make with respect to audit of notes payable. So we have to determine class whether internal controls over notes payable are adequate, whether the transactions for principal and interest payment are properly authorized, recorded, and presented, and the liability and yung related interest expense and accrual are properly stated, aggregated, and presented in the notes to financial statements, including yung information about collateral. With respect to internal, they might expect nothing controls over notes payable. So there should be a proper authorization for issue of notes. So where can we trace that? Normally, from the minutes of meetings of the board. So kasi yung issuance of notes, it's a significant transaction on the part of the company. So since it creates obligation or liability. So therefore, it should be properly authorized. And then there should be adequate controls over the repayment of principal and interest. Proper documents and records are required, especially pag may mga collateral. So sometimes it would need notarization pa of the related debt instrument or paper, pati mga doc stamp, for example. And there should be periodic independent verification by proper officers or official within the entity. So for test of control and substantive test of transaction, so these are the consideration, no? So we apply test of control and test of transaction in the issuance and repayment of notes. And normally, yung TOC and test of transaction natin, part na rin ng test natin ng other cycles. Like for example, sa proceeds ng note, we do that as part of audit of cash receipts. Sa repayment naman ng principal and interest, we do that as part of our audit of cash disbursement. So however, additional tests may be required because of the materiality of the item. So kaya for example, na-identify natin na yung cash receipts and cash disbursement are related to issuance of note and repayment ng principal and interest, so we may perform additional tests to verify the accuracy and authorization, for example, of those activities or transactions. So, procedures naman, these are some analytical procedures that we perform over notes payable and interest expense. Normally, yung analytical procedures natin address toward interest expense. So, we can compute for the interest expense for reasonability by comparing yung average interest rate over the sa monthly average notes payable ni client, okay? Or average balance ng notes payable. We can also compare the individual notes payable balances ng current year and prior year. And compare yung mga balances sa notes payable, interest expense, and even accrual ng interest compared sa prior period. So to determine potential misstatements in both interest expense and notes payable. So details of balances naman, these are our major objectives. So our objectives in test of details of balances of notes include whether existing notes payable are included, that is completeness. So because after all, notes payable are liabilities, so therefore we emphasize the audit of completeness. Another is accuracy, whether notes payable in the schedule are accurately recorded. And finally, the presentation. Now, notes payable are properly aggregated and presented, and the related disclosures are adequate and understandable. Okay? Now, for the audit of other long-term debt, like loans payable, mortgage payable, or banks payable, we follow the same audit procedure as with audit of notes payable. So now let's jump to audit naman account. So sa audit of equity account, so we have the owner's equity, the share capital, and the related equity items. Now there is a distinction to the audit procedures between what we call publicly held companies and closely held corporation. So why? So kasi yung quantity ng equity transactions and even yung structure ng mga documents and record could differ between the two types of companies. For example, for publicly held companies, we expect that there are large number of shareholders and there are frequent changes in the individuals holding the shares of stocks. And therefore, It is more complex to audit compared to audit of closely held corporation. So kasi sa closely held corporation, we expect few shareholders only, and limited shareholders equity transactions would occur during the year. Okay? So yung mga relevant accounts naman sa owner's equity, we have capital, paid in capital, and the common shares. We have share premium, retained earnings, and dividends. So few items na yung na-expect natin i-audit when we talk about equity transactions and balances. For internal control consideration, so this is what we consider. So internal controls over share capital and related dividends should be adequate. Owner's equity transaction should be correctly recorded, and owner's equity balances are properly recorded and presented. Now, for equity-related transactions, following are the internal controls that we expect to be present. So one, there should be proper authorization of transaction, especially with respect to issuance ng share capital, repurchase of capital, and declaration of dividends. So that is why almost all equity-related transactions, we can trace them to a specific document. So which document is that? Minutes of meetings of the board of directors. So kasi all of these transactions are normally approved by the board. So we can expect to trace them to the minutes of meetings of board of directors. So there should also be proper record keeping and segregation of duties. And for material equity-related transactions, especially for publicly listed companies, so they should engage an independent registrar and stock transfer agent. Often, this is required for publicly listed companies. So for smaller companies, they are not required, but they are encouraged also, no, to engage independent registrar and stock transfer agent. In case they do not engage independent registrar and stock transfer agent, then it would be the company itself who will manage their share-related transactions. So, but if it is publicly listed and they are required, so yung independent registrar, ang role niya is to monitor, no, or to hold the records of the shareholders. So therefore, the independent registrar will manage the information about the existing shareholders and the removal or addition of shareholders in the registry of shareholders of the company. So ang role naman ng stock transfer agent, they facilitate na yung transfer ng shares among shareholders. So kaya upon authorization of the registrar, the stock transfer agent will facilitate the issuance or the reacquisition of shares from the related shareholders. So therefore, yung recording stock transfer agent and the registrar should also agree with each other. So si registrar, parang siya yung record keeping, si stock transfer agent, more of custody ng mga share-related documents. So audit of paid-in capital. So sa audit naman ng paid-in capital, here are the major objectives that we consider. So one is completeness. So existing capital share transactions are recorded. Recorded share capital transaction occurred and are accurately recorded. So this is occurrence and accuracy. So share capital is accurately recorded, accuracy, and share capital is properly presented and disclosed. So sa test of details of balances and transaction, so it's relatively easy to perform kasi we expect only a few transactions. So and we can trace them easily to the minutes of meetings of the board of directors. And we can recalculate, halimbawa, yung issuance of shares or yung acquisition of treasury shares against supporting documents. Like for example, cash receipt and cash disbursement. So for dividends naman, in auditing dividends, the emphasis is on audit of transactions and yung authorization. Kasi dividends, it should be authorized by the board of directors. Again, no problem. So we can easily trace it to the minutes of board meeting. We can also review debt agreements for restriction. Kasi oftentimes class, pag si client meron silang existing loan agreement or debt agreement, there would be restriction in the declaration of dividend or payment of dividend. So we have to also consider that. Kasi si client, si entity, they can only declare out of their unrestricted retained earnings. So we can also recalculate the dividends and trace them to cash disbursement. And in case there are portion of unpaid dividends by year end, trace them to the accrual of the entity. And last part, audit of retained earnings. So yung retained earnings naman class, again, this is relatively easy to audit because there are only limited transactions sa RE. Ano lang may transaction sa RE? Yung net income, tsaka yung dividend. So yung net income, we can trace it in the income statement of the client. So whatever yung amount ng income from the income statement, yun dapat yung nakareflect sa credit sa retained earnings. Yung dividend naman, we can trace it dun sa result ng audit natin sa dividend. So ano yung mga other transactions that could affect the RE? Yung mga prior period adjustments sa earnings or prior period adjustments arising from changes in accounting policy of the client. In auditing those naman, so we have to consider yung appropriateness ng entries or the transaction with respect to accounting requirement or accounting standards. Halimbawa, yung adjustment pa sa earnings is in accordance with the appropriate accounting standard. Okay, yung change in accounting policy, appropriate or justified ba? So therefore, we establish whether that entry in the RE should really be there. And other transactions include, so setting up or elimination of appropriations. In that case, we can review loan agreements, debt agreements, and minutes of meetings of the board of director. So kaya usually ang starting point natin in auditing RE is we ask for the client's analysis of the movements in retained earnings during the year. So yun. So analysis of RE for the year. Let's answer the remaining questions.